Mr. Sanjay Seth, Chief Executive Officer, Griha Council, and Senior Director, Sustainable Habitat Division, TERI. Dr. Ashok Kumar, Senior Principal Scientist, Head Architecture and Planning Group and Efficiency of Building Group, Central Building Research Institute. Claudio Maffioletti, Secretary General, Indo-Italian Chamber of Commerce. Mr. Supradeep Das, Consultant Editor, Civil Engineering and Construction Review. Ms. Nidhi Dixit, ICMQ India, and facilitator for the Technical Committee on MISPM project. Mr. Amol Desai, General Manager, Supreme Petrochemicals Private Limited. And Mr. Rajiv Singhal, Product Manager, Schnell India Private Limited. So I welcome you all to our special session on Make It Sustainable Building Materials, Standards for Eco-Products Certification in the Indian Construction Industry. May I invite Mr. Sanjay Seth, the Chief Executive Officer, Griha Council, and the Senior Director, Sustainable Habitat Division, TERI, to please give us his inaugural address.
Ladies and gentlemen, my fellow speakers on the dais, it's indeed a privilege to be here today on this session which has been put together by the Indo-Italian Chambers of Commerce. I think my compliments to Mr. Maffioletti, okay, so I need to be pretty sure about your pronunciations that I don't go wrong. It's indeed a privilege to be here. I know it's the first session in the morning. It's always, it's difficult to find people in the hall, but I'm glad that some of you are still here. Otherwise, we are used to even speaking to maybe empty halls at 10 in the morning. So, but having said that, I think there is some kind of work that we've put together with the Indo-Italian Chambers of Commerce in the Griha Council, in where we have engaged ourselves. You know, on one hand, when we are rating buildings under the Griha system, materials become a very integral part in how you go about having enough material in the market, which is really going to be pushing sustainability, across its barriers. So, what I would like to do today is that I would like to spend some time, giving you a background as to where the policies of the government are and how we fit into that space of making sure that, that we move ahead as well on this task. I think we are all aware that there is a special emphasis of the Government of India as far as housing for all, and it's called now Sustainable Housing for All. I think that policy itself is with the intent of promoting social housing. And when we talk of social housing, what we need to be careful of is that, that it's not that they are talking about high-end houses or houses which would be able to afford technologies to make sure that they are comfortable to live in. It's very important that when we look at the social housing perspective, they should be thermally comfortable for the common man to be living out of, because the only, in a country like ours, which is a tropical country and where primarily it's the cooling loads, which we require, what happens is that the person who is living out of that habitat, the primary equipment that he is going to be using for his cooling requirements is basically the fan, and the fan would cool down, whatever air is within that house. It will help to kind of circulate that air, and that's how it helps you to cool it in the absence of an air conditioner. So air conditioner is not something which is going to be working out of these houses. So the idea is that we have to make these houses or these habitats so thermally comfortable that while he's dependent only on that fan, he's able to live comfortably out of this house. In TERI, we have put together we have established a center of excellence where we are looking at innovative, locally available material which can be used for construction of these houses. And this has been put together with the Center of Excellence has been put together with the Mahindra Life Spaces Development Limited, MLDL, and Terry. And what we are going to be doing is, what we are doing in fact is, that you know there is a lot of material which is locally available in different climatic zones of the country. But we have to see that whether this material can be made available at very cheap prices, and they should be sustainable, and also, of course, keeping the overall requirements of strength and stability in mind. We have very recently put together, we put out an expression of interest where we have invited various manufacturers of such material to come forward and then give us their uniqueness of those materials so that we can test them in this Center of Excellence, which is essentially a lab. And thereafter, we see, you know, that how is the marketability of these material. And then once we have established that, we put it out in the public domain for people to be using such material so that sustainability can go ahead a step further. Now, Mahindra Life Spaces have also given us their projects that they are constructing to be ensuring that, you know, while we are talking about this new material that is going to be available in the market, to ratify them on their projects. So the you know, the when we are talking of the lab to the actual construction sites, they have allowed us to, you know, they would provide us their live projects to be using such material to demonstrate its applicability. Now, on the front of the Indo-Italian chambers, there is also a sustainability index that we are talking about, that how we could probably, you know, look at such material being made available in the market. Now, the challenge obviously is that, you know, when we are talking of green constructions, when we are talking of sustainable constructions, the obvious thing that comes to the mind of the people is that where do I get material to be constructing such housing or to be constructing such buildings. In our earlier, you know, what you call avatar, I mean, when we used to be working with the Bureau of Energy Efficiency, there we found that, you know, the labels that we provide on appliances, that's a market changer, you know, that's a game changer in the market. How people are empowered to make an informed choice of efficient versus a non-efficient equipment appliance. Now, a similar exercise if we do for materials, I think then we are empowering the end user, the customer, to make sure that this material complies with the certain requirements which are at the end of it going to deliver sustainability. So the idea is that the sustainability index, whatever is being developed, that matrix, once we put out in the public domain, it has some credibility of the due diligence having been done at the back end by agencies such as Terry and the others to ensure that, you know, all the checks that are required to be done as far as those materials which people are claiming are sustainable and efficient or will be delivering the required, you know, the requirements that are required to achieve sustainability at a cost which is what should I say, that, you know, when you look at that curve, that on one hand we have sustainability, on the other hand the prices are rock bottom. So then it becomes, you know, we are able to empower the consumer to be making those informed choices available to him to be using such material so that the you know, the house that he's ultimately planning to construct becomes sustainable. Now, we have done some such work, a part of it has been done. We in our Bangalore office, we have done for social housing, we have prepared a sustainability index matrix. But now we are working together at a much larger, seeing how we could really scale it up. Very frankly, beyond a few meetings between them, we haven't really moved ahead. But I'm sure that in the months ahead, there will be much more action or on both the sides to be taking this forward. It's also important to note that we've just come. I believe that we have been in a transition period where the earlier team, which was working on in Terry, has since moved on, and there is a new team which is there, and we've just reached out to our partners on the Italian side, and we are thinking of how to go about accelerating this so that we could come out as soon as possible with this matrix on sustainability index. One of the key things I think that we also need to remember is that much of our housing requirements and much of our infrastructure development is still at its construction or at its planning stages. So that gives us an edge to make sure that, you know, whatever we do now will help us to ensure that sustainability comes into the forefront of all our actions that we are going to take in the next couple of years. A number of policies have been put together by the government. There have been regulatory frameworks that have been put together. But what we find is that obviously a lot of work needs to be done on building up capacities to make sure that these policies, you see, having these policies in place and not having enough capacities in the urban local bodies and in the state governments or in the housing, practitioners, the building practitioners, they will not really be able to, the policies will then obviously not be effective. So all of these actions, it is a time taking, it's a cumbersome process. I gave you an example of an appliance standard and how it has helped us to change the market, the consumer behavior towards efficient appliances. But we must understand that a building is not an appliance, it is a much larger scale. And in order to make sure that these consumer transformation or the behavioral changes that are required will have to be backed up with credible instruments available. And a lot of information, a lot of capacities in the market will have to be built up simultaneously so that the shift towards sustainability or the objective of achieving sustainability or, you know, that can really move forward. I have my colleagues here, a number of them, some of them we have been associated in the past too, and even in my current assignment they have been working closely with me. I look forward to their presentations, I look forward to their thoughts. There is some people who are on the research and academia who have worked together both in the Bureau of Energy Efficiency with me as well as continue to work with me in Terry. So I look forward to the deliberations, to the presentations that are going to be made. And then, of course, as I say that, you know, such conferences, such events should not be for only sermonizing, but it has to be an interactive platform so that we get to know as to where the course corrections are required to be made at our end so that we are able to transform these habitats towards sustainability. I thank you very much for being here today, and I thank you for your attention.
Thank you very much for your remarks, sir. And may I now call upon Dr. Ashok Kumar, the Senior Principal Scientist and Head Architecture and Planning Group, Central Building Research Institute, Roorkee.
Good morning. Dignitaries on the dais and off the dais, ladies and gentlemen. At the outset, I am thankful to the Indo-Italian Chamber for inviting me to this seminar and giving me this opportunity to share some of my experiences, the thoughts, and the research work that we have been doing in the last few years in CBRI. I'll just give you a brief background of what we have been doing You know, CBRI is the only institution in the country wherein under one roof we talk about each and every aspect of building science and technology. You talk about architecture, you talk about building efficiency, you talk about any kind of building materials, you talk about fire research, the structural engineering. You know, under one roof, this is the only institute in the country wherein we have been doing research for the last more than 60 years. The institute was established in the year 1947 and has generated, cultivated and promoted building science and technology in the service of the country and developed several building materials and the technologies. And these materials and technologies have been, you know, utilized all across the country in several lakhs of buildings and houses. We have developed guidelines, codes and standards, and you'll find, you know, each and every component. If you see most of the research that we have been doing, you'll find National Building Code is one of the documents wherein all such research outcomes have been included. Even the Bureau of Energy Efficiency, wherein some of the outcomes, you know, when we started working in the year 2007, you know, then all these research outcomes have been included. So if you see the construction industry challenges, you know, we have the climate change, the energy shortages, the urbanization, infrastructure. So some solutions to these challenges are definitely, you know, in terms of sustainable building materials and technologies. If I talk about the climate change, there is obviously, you know, need to reduce the greenhouse gas emissions to combat the global warming. And cement production, if you see, 1 ton of cement, you know, produces about 0.9 tons of CO2. So that we need to take care of. And we also need to take care of the conservation of our natural resources. And if I see, you know, the construction industry, which is a larger contributor to the CO2 emissions, with buildings responsible for almost, you know, 40% of the total energy consumption and about 1/3 of the CO2 emissions. And this means that half of the carbon emissions are indirectly produced by buildings. And if I see the environmental impact of building materials, you talk about any resources, you know, energy, water, materials for building. Now, if you see the percentage, you know, 40 to 45%, and the agricultural loss that we are attributing to buildings, 80%, you know. And similarly, the other problems like, you know, the air pollution, the air quality problem, the climate change, and things like that. And if you see the environmental impact of the building, energy is consumed, you know, during the manufacture of the materials, that is the embedded or the embodied energy. Then the transportation of the materials from production plants to the building sites, which is the gray energy. Then the construction of the building material, the construction of the buildings, which is the induced energy, and the operation of the building, which is the operational energy. And all these, you know, whatever the environmental impact that we have to, you know, take into consideration when we are constructing other buildings. If I talk about cement, you know, which is the largest, you know, material which is being used in the buildings. So 1 ton of cement produces about 0.9 ton of CO2, and which is responsible for about 8% of the overall CO2 emissions. And average consumption of the concrete is around 1 ton per person per year. So that means if we cannot, you know, find alternative solution to the cement, I think we are going to pollute the environment. Similarly, if you talk about the bricks, substantial amount of energy is required in firing of bricks, you know, and as it is heated for 5 hours at a temperature of around 1,000 degrees Celsius. So India has about more than, you know, 1 lakh brick kilns producing about 250 billion bricks annually, and are estimated to consume about 25 million tons of coal per year. So that means all these, you know, if you are not able to find out the alternative solutions, these are going to create problems for the country. And if you see the construction process, as I mentioned, right from the mining, drilling, extraction to the manufacture and distribution, the transportation, the distribution, building, maintenance and the life cycle, demolition and recycle, majority of the energy consumption and the environmental impacts, you know, they take place during the entire life cycle stage. And if I see the green building concept, which is the theme of today's talk, you know, the SRA standard 189.1, describes the high performance green building as building which is designed, constructed, and capable of being operated in a manner that increases environmental performance and economic value over time. That means we need to take care of the environmental performance as well as the economic value over time. You see the examples of, you know, some buildings which are considered as, you know, green buildings, wherein you will find that WWR, window to wall ratio, more than 80%. But if you see in composite climate, these buildings are both an oven during summer and refrigerated in a cold climate. So if you see, these are not green buildings. And wherein in CBRI, when we talk about greenness, the CBRI's perspective is, wherein we talk about green, there has to be sustainability, the ecology, and the performance, you know, all in hand. And all these drivers of sustainability, if I talk about, you know, 11.2 billion hectares, you know, land, and around 7 billion people in the world, 1.7, you know, global hectare per person that we have, if we are not able to, balance this land, our future generations will have, you know, problems. And that's why, you know, we talk about sustainability, ecology, and performance, which require, you know, the elements, the resources, and environmental, wherein in buildings can completely be or barely sustainable or unsustainable, depending upon the number of attributes it possesses within each of these categories, whether we are talking about the elements, resources, and the environmental aspects. So that means when you talk about sustainability, the use of resources to meet our needs without depriving the resources for future generations that we need to take care of, that's why in CBRI we always talk about optimization of the energy usage, use of environmental friendly materials and products, enhancing the indoor environmental quality and the optimized OM practices, and create built environment that is livable, comfortable, safe, and productive. Mr. Seth was mentioning about the housing. Only a day before yesterday, we had a delegation from Ministry of Rural Development, you know, wherein we are joining hands with the UNDP, wherein we are providing solutions to 13 states of the country in providing the affordable, safe, comfortable, and energy efficient solutions, utilizing both CBRI technologies as well as the using locally available building materials. In the coming months, we are going to target the balance of the country. That means they have given us a target of around 51 lakh houses to be constructed in next few months, and wherein we are targeting MP, UP, Assam, and a few other states. When we are designing these sustainable buildings, the essential objective in designing these sustainable buildings is to decrease energy consumption over life cycle of building components with minimum environmental impacts. And life cycle assessment technique is used to compare building components alternatives and lead towards more sustainable and environmental friendly substitute. So the sustainable building design requires the analysis of environmental performance in every stage of their life cycle, wherein we talk about reduced energy demand and increased efficiency, and also the use of low energy sources or renewable energy sources. And we also talk about, when we are talking about the climatic zone, the localized macroclimate and also a microclimate. This is another very important work that we are doing right now, you know, under Indo-US project sponsored by Indo-US Science and Technology Forum, where we are going to modify the climatic map of India, wherein we are talking about the local severities, you know, particularly in the composite climate. If you see, you know, the climate of Roorkee is also composite climate, or Delhi is also composite climate, and Lucknow is also composite. But if you see the local severities, you know, you'll find that there's a huge amount of difference in the climate. So that means there is need to update the existing map that we have. So we are under process of developing this. That's why, you know, if you see the approach that we are following in CBRI, and we are promoting, is that particularly, you know, if you see the special publication 41, which is the handbook on functional requirement of buildings, wherein we talk about climate responsiveness and the bioclimatic approach to architecture, wherein we are saying that, you know, keeping the window to wall ratio as low as possible, you know, 25% to 30%, and wall masonry blocks, you know, as compared to high energy efficient glass. If you see the total reduction in the body energy, if you convert this, you know, say around 4,500 megajoule per square meter to 500, you know, megajoule, 1/9, you know, we can reduce the embodied energy and other parameters that we always, you know, promote and take into consideration. Some of the products, technologies that we have developed and are being used across the country are, you know, cleaner and environmental friendly technologies, particularly, you know, the air pollution control by improved production and of these, you know, gravitational centering chamber of brick kilns, wherein, you know, lakhs of, you know, these brick kilns have been constructed using these technologies, and utilization of the fly ash, you know, another component wherein we have promoted several products utilizing the fly ash technology. Doors and windows, wherein we are talking about Swachh Bharat, and we have, you know, developed these products using the pine needles, the rice husk, and the jute, and these are all, you know, conforming to the Indian standards, and they are also economical. And also, there is a huge amount of waste which is generated, and we have developed several alternative technologies using these waste, particularly the stone waste, this quota stone waste, the CND waste, and fluoro gypsum. And several walling options have been developed in the past and in the recent times also. And you'll find that clay fly ash bricks and the fly ash lime bricks, the hollow and solid concrete blocks, and for the roofing and the RCC planks and joist brick panel system, these all contribute around 25% of the, you know, cost savings, as well as 25% to 30% energy savings. The wood without trees, you know, is one of the finest technologies recently developed by CBRI, wherein the rice husk plastic wood has been utilized, and these are the raw materials, the rice husk polymers, additives, and the end products are doors, windows, profiles, and fencing, the flooring, decking, and you can talk about anything. Similarly, the composite boards and material using these waste, you know, pine needles, as I mentioned, in the Himalayas, the Western Himalayan, the total production is around 2.7 million tons, you know, which is produced, and this has been utilized in the form of making these pine needle composite boards. Fluoro gypsum, you know, 1 million tons of byproduct for fluoro gypsum is produced from these hydrofluoric acid industries in India, and this has been utilized in developing the high strength plaster, which is called, as you know, cement-free plaster, right? So similarly, the choir CSNL board have been developed. Then agro waste utilization, bagasse cement boards are developed, and you'll find these materials and the products used all across the country by several agencies. And if you see the life cycle assessment results of different kinds of building materials, right from the conventional one, ordinary brick, and the sand lime brick, you'll find that there is a huge amount of, you know, savings in the CO2, and all these materials are having low embodied energy as well as lower CO2 emissions. Some of the materials, these have been utilized in a few of these housing, particularly nearer to Delhi, you'll find Mawana area and Rewari area. Several thousands of houses have been constructed, and the cost is almost around 800 rupees to 900 rupees square foot, as compared to the other one, which is the private builders are selling, you know, around 1500 rupees. So almost, 60 to 65% cheaper, you know. And we have also studied several other, buildings wherein we are talking about use of insulation. If you talk about energy conservation building code, which says that, you know, we have to meet U value requirement of for walling and the roofing, If you see the U value and the for the walling and the roofing, none of the walling and the roofing, they meet the criteria if you see the existing values. So that means we need to talk about some interventions that with some interventions these values are met, and we have given several options, and these options have been referred to BEE for its adoption, and we have done a study using these options, and if I see the number of cases where we have tried to evaluate experimentally, all these cases, seven cases, they contribute to about 34% reduction in energy, and this is enormous. You can achieve a lot of savings in terms of energy and CO2 emissions. And to sum up, I can say that there is a vast scope in utilizing the technologies, alternative technologies, be it the affordable housing or sustainable housing, or you talk about any green buildings, and there's need to talk about active and passive interventions and improving the microclimate of the environment around the buildings. And there's also a need for certification of materials conforming to different standards. And it's not just, making a stamp and getting the certificates. The whole set of testing is to be done properly through some certified agencies. Thank you very much. For any, information, you can write to Director CBRI, or you can talk to, you can write to me as well. Thank you very much for your patient listening.
Thank you, sir. Thank you very much for your remarks. I would like to now call upon Mr. Claudio Maffioletti, the Secretary General of the Indo-Italian Chamber of Commerce and Industry, to give his remarks on the project. Bring the PPT. That's
fine. Well, I would like to thank, first of all, the organizers for giving us the opportunity of having this session on the Make It Sustainable Building Materials. I'd like to thank also all the panelists, the gentlemen which have introduced the session, and they have aptly defined the field of action of this project of developed and promoted by the Indo-Italian Chamber of Commerce. I would also like to thank all the companies and the media partners which have taken place on the dais and who will be sharing with us what their experience has been, is being, and most importantly, will be in developing products, processes, techniques which are based on international standards and which are above all verified by third parties. The need of the day, and Mr. Setti and Dr. Kapoor have very, very clearly define what is the need of the day in a country like India, with the amount of populations living in its mega cities, the rate of growth that the building and construction industry will have in the next 5 to 6 years, considering also the ambitious plans of the current government to increase substantially the number of affordable and social housing for the majority of the population, the need and the issue of resource consumption in an industry which is by nature highly intensive, whose use of natural resources is highly intensive, is a big problem, but it can also be an equally big opportunity. The reason why we decided to embark in a project a couple of years ago to promote sustainable building materials in India is that, as bilateral organization, both Indian and Italian organization, we tend to promote and share with our Indian members and stakeholders what has been the experience of Italian and European companies in various fields. Building and construction materials and sustainability is definitely one of the areas in which Italy and Europe have developed an extensive experience. In a recent research made by an Italian NGO, it was found out that 42% of Italian companies active in the building and construction industries are green or go green. The terms core green or go green refer to different levels of environmental performance and environmental sustainability of the processes and the technology that they use to produce the materials. We understood well before the present government made it a flagship project the importance of smart technologies for the smart city project in India. In 2011, we launched a very first smart city project when the today Prime Minister of India was the Chief Minister of Gujarat. We presented it to him. Perhaps he got inspired by the project that we have presented to him to make it in Indian city smart. The project was based on a few pillars: living space, energy, governance, environmental, environment and mobility. The acronym for that is LEGEM. And it was basically a human-centric concept for a sustainable city. We have become, a couple of years ago, 3 years ago to be precise, ambassadors in India of a community of organizations, professionals, and institutions promoting sustainability principles around the world. And we have launched in 2015 the project Making Sustainable Building Materials, which has been supported and co-financed by the European Union and executed in collaboration with a pool of Indian and European partners. What is the rationale behind the MISBM project? The rationale is that governmental initiatives like National Building Code, Green Building Certification Schemes, GRIHA, IGBC, and LEED, and practitioners, architects, projects, developers, or public bodies generally refer to local standards, which not always, even though the latest issue, the latest versions of the National Building Code does have a specific reference to need of using sustainable materials, but normally environmental performance for building and materials is not one element which is taken so much into consideration. These materials normally require a self-declared environmental claim by the manufacturer, but not always, in very, very few cases, there is a reference to standards, testing methods, acceptance criteria, and third-party validation of such declarations. So the mission of the whole entire project is to provide and to define a framework for improving the transparency and reliability for green building rating systems in India by rewarding building materials with environmental claims and labels which are verified by third parties in accordance to international standards. So the first step of the project was to define the field of action, so to put together and describe with details what are the criteria according to which building materials can or should be certified. We have decided to concentrate on three families of products. Mortar, cement, and concrete is one family. Bricks and tiles is another one. Waterproofing and insulation is a third one. For these protocols, third-party certification scheme owners can develop their own schemes. So we are providing the benchmarks according to which the scheme owners and the certification bodies can refer to in order to develop their own scheme and certification products. The target is interesting because it's not only targeting European manufacturers exporting to India, European manufacturers manufacturing in India, but it is also targeting Indian manufacturers manufacturing in India who need and want to provide to their product which can be recognized for their environmental sustainability or in any case for their environmental age and need to be marketed and they need to be positioned in a different way. The beneficiaries of this project are builders and developers, which can widen the value proposition for the end users and the clients, and obviously consumers and end users at large, since they will have a wider choice of materials or real estate options which can be promoted and marketed as sustainable, because there is a third party which actually says this kind of materials, this building has been made using specific kind of materials which are recognized for the sustainability. We have developed these protocols engaging a wide array of professionals, practitioners, companies, associations, intermediate bodies, institutions, both European and Indian. So the level of consensus for the definition of the parameters which define each and every protocol has been as wide as possible. We have established some strategic partnership with GRIA is for us was the top choice, considering the level of knowledge and the level of importance they give to locally available solutions, which is key for any kind of sustainable thought or sustainable thinking. We are obviously discussing and having some open exchanges of opinion with other green building certification scheme owners. Media, one of them is with us today. We have been writing a few articles specifically targeting and trying to explain what can be the intrinsic environmental features of some specific products manufactured in India or for the Indian market, and promotion events and roadshows like the one that we are organizing today. One of the first results of these 2+ years of work has been the very first company which has been certified, whose product has been certified because of their environmental sustainability, which has been recognized by a certification body, which is ICMQ India. And we have our colleague later on, she will explain in more details what has been the whole process which has led to this kind of certification. This certification has been made with a reference to the protocols of the environmental products which have been defined as part of the Make It Sustainable Building Materials. This is just one. This is the first of, we hope and we are sure, will be many other certifications for building materials which will be popping up in the Indian market. The governance of the whole project implies a set of technical committees, as I said, for each family of products, plus there is a review committee which has the task of validating the contents of the protocols at the end of the entire process of defining the parameters by the technical committees. We have one technical committee on cement, concrete and mortars, another one on bricks and tiles, waterproofing and insulation. This is in progress. We have closed the protocol of environmental products for the bricks, for the cement and mortars. The bricks and tiles is still in the final stages, as well as the waterproofing and insulation, which is just about to be approved by the review committee. The way ahead for the project is to extend the purview of the protocols to other families of products. Doors and windows, marbles and stones, steel, anything going into the construction of a building. Work to improve and to support more and more sustainable building materials manufactured or marketed in India by empaneling more and more certification body to have product certification for such products. Organizing B2B meetings with influencers, decision makers of builders and developers, and develop, this is the, if I may say so, the most ambitious and the most interesting possible outcome of the whole project, to develop a model, a system, an integrated housing system which is fully sustainable easily, which can be put easily in place in every area of the country and that can be affordable for the largest portion of the society. Besides that, we are more and more developing our strategic partnership to disseminate information, generate awareness, and provide visibility to the project, to the companies involved, and to the products which have been certified. So, without much further ado, I would close this first initial part. I hope it's the presentation of the project has been clear enough for you to understand what we are talking about. What is going to follow is a series of experiences by companies which have gone, are going, will be going through the whole certification body for the building materials. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Mr. Mafioletti, for your presentation on the project. May I now invite for the next session Mr. Supradeep Das. He is the editorial consultant for Civil Engineering and Construction Review, our media partner, to please moderate the session.
Good morning, distinguished guests and ladies and gentlemen. It's my great pleasure to be here as a moderator and would like to thank the Italian Chamber of Commerce and Industry for inviting me to a part of the panel discussions. Before we talk about the sustainability, I must talk about the why we talk about the sustainability today or the green products. My co-presenter, Dr. Ashok Kumar, has already given some details about the emission, the carbon dioxide emission in the air and other products which are the reason for global warming. For your information, I would like to share with you the carbon footprints in cement industry is the highest. According to the research, one metric ton of cement produces one metric ton of carbon dioxide. But what happens if India produces 240 million tons of cement? In that case, if the 60% of the cement is being used in the concrete, there is a catch. There is a 15 to 20% of that carbon dioxide is also absorbed during the carbonation. So we need to, whatever that 80% carbon dioxide emission is too high. So we need to go for a no cement concrete or some alternate cementitious product that I will discuss later on. Then another area is the production of fly ash. 150 million tons of fly ash is being generated through the thermal power plants in India, and 20 to 25% are being used as described by Dr. Ashok Kumar. So in that case, it is very, you know, since all these non-renewable products are being used, the reserve are being depleted, we should look for an alternate products which are green products. So what is the meaning of the green products? The concept of green or the sustainable building incorporates and integrates a variety of strategies during the design, construction, operation of building project. The use of green building materials and products represent one important strategy in the designing of the buildings. Green buildings material offer specific benefits to the building owners. Reduce maintenance, replacement cost over the life of building, energy conservation, like what we talk about the use of alternate cementitious construction products. Whatever the byproduct is being used, whether it's a phosphogypsum, fluorogypsum, or fly ash, or slag from the steel plant, that has to be used to its maximum. These are all green products. And they are lower cost all associated with the changing space configuration, greater design flexibility. building and construction activity worldwide consumes 3 billion tons of raw materials each year and 40% of the global use. Using green building materials and products promotes conservation of dwindling renewable resources internationally. In addition, integrating green building materials into building projects can also help reduce the environmental impact associated with the extraction, transport, processing, fabrication, installation, reuse, recycling, and disposal of these building materials. For example, in India today, it has become a great problem to dispose that 120 million tons of fly ash which is being generated annually. So there are the CBRI, the research institutes, they have developed some value addition products, some innovative utilization of these byproduct wastes. Now, why we have already Indian standard specification for these products, but we do not have any evaluation criteria or the certification. So we need the green product certification by a third party. Why? These are intended to outline and confirm that a product meets a particular standard and offers an environmental benefit. Many product level certification programs certify products based on life cycle parameters, making them multi-attribute products. These parameters include energy use, recycled content, and air and water emissions from manufacturing, disposal, and use. Others focus on a single attribute such as water, energy, chemical emission that directs impact IEQ. A green product certification is considered most respected when an independent third party is responsible for conducting the product testing and awarding the certification. Third party means they are independent of the product manufacturer, contractor, designer, and specifier. Third party label and the green product certification program can be useful in evaluating the attributes of green product because they validate that the product meets certain industry independent standards. They can also offer greater assurance to consumers, designers, specifiers, and others that a product marketing claims accurately reflects the green attributes. ISO-defined types of green product certification labels are already defined. That is type 1 ISO 14024, type 2 ISO 14021, and ISO 14025. The reason of pursuing a green building certification for a projects are varied. Certification through any rating provides verification of the green nature of the project, can be a valuable educational and marketing tool for owners, designs, and construction team through the process of creating a more sustainable building. Green building certification can also be a way to provide an incentive for clients, owners, designers, and users to develop, promote a highly sustainable construction practice. It is important to note that building does not have to be certified to be sustainable and well built. I have just come to know that this AEP has been given the green certificate by a third party for their concrete paver block using very high percentage of recycled material. So that will be presented by Nidhi Dixit. Before that, I would like to conclude my remarks with that remarks. The need of the hour is to go for a certified building materials and the value-added products. We do have Indian certificates, BI certification, for a particular byproduct being used in building as a building materials, whether it is in the manufacture of cement or a concrete or certain like fly ash bricks, they have already developed. It is being used in a very big way. But these bricks or these valuable products needs to be certified by a third party certificating agency. So with this, I conclude my remarks on the need of the hour of the for the certification. I would now request invite Nidhi Dixit to present her case study on the third party certification.
Good morning, everyone. Is it audible? It's not audible. It's audible? Oh, okay. So starting with what sir had already covered, the SBM program had an outcome called Get It Green as a certification scheme by ICMQ. So basically the certification scheme is based on ISO standards, that is 14021, 24 and 25. And it has a life cycle approach, that is 14044. So basically talking about the current scenario, right now there are many companies whose environmental claims we have been doubting as architects, as builders. So as sir mentioned, there's a company called AEP which recently got certified. Now the product they had was completely recycled waste. But honestly speaking, when you talk about paver blocks made from construction and demolition waste, everybody here thinks that it is 100% recycled. But after the testing is done and after it is evaluated according to ISO standards, you would see further on, you know, how it comes to a certain percentage and it is not 100% as the company usually declares it to be and as per our understanding. The second part is there are many industries which lack support in terms of exporting their products to the European market, where the standards are stringent in terms of what you are declaring and what are your environmental claims. And lastly, we talk about getting credits or score in certification schemes like GRIHA and DEET. Right now, if I'm not wrong, sir, is it right now you have an LCA credit kind of system which is somewhere into the picture for green materials. So that is in the line in the new certification scheme. That is what we are looking forward to. The criteria overview to give you an idea is we've got raw material based criteria. You might be using bio-based material, recycled material, you have recovered material. Then in the manufacturing stage, we concentrate on the water use, energy used, water consumption, waste management. Here I would say total GHG emission is a very critical point which right now various certification schemes are overviewing it, and it's only related to the product and not to the overall factory usage. You have the use phase characteristics of environmental criteria. They have physical properties, as sir mentioned, there are U values, R values, insulation values. So there are other criteria which you declare as a company which we verify as a third party body. You have firefighting properties. Then there is an end of life phase. Here this is a very, you could say, a very dicey point, where only and only if your city has that facility to recycle your building product, then only you can claim this point, which usually companies declare it as a recycled product without even the knowledge of whether that product could be recycled within your own city or municipality limits. And then lastly, it is designed for disassembly. So current issues in the eco certification schemes is we have lack of transparency. There is no reference to the international standards. There is a poor reference to the product life cycle because of our lack of understanding. And there is no link with EPD. Here I would like to introduce with EPD is Environmental Product Declaration, which is an international way of following for products based on life cycle analysis. Right now, LEED certification scheme does mention this point, and even Griha mentions that life cycle analysis is important. So better way to do it is we have a credibility, transparency and reliability. Now credibility comes only when there is a proper set of reference documents. So the PEPs are our reference documents and the ISO standards. The transparency is it is a publicly available document and the certification is provided as a certificate which can be published on your website and can be declared. And it is we as a certification body is an independent body which certifies your product. So I have already covered this point. Get It Green is under the, it follows the PEPs. So ICMQ has been doing this for 10 years in Europe right now, and we have an India office in Bombay. The accreditation is also required for us to do the certification scheme, that is Get It Green. So that is also, it is the first body in India to provide a product certification scheme for building materials specifically, and Get It Green has been approved by the Chamber of Commerce. So currently the scheme has a modular and scalable approach. So if you see, you at the first level, we do not expect that you go ahead and you know do all the criteria all together. So you follow a step-by-step process. The first time you do it, you do a 1 to 5 types of criteria at the level which the company is and wants to declare the criteria. Then that is the bronze level. Then you go up to the silver, gold, platinum, platinum plus. When you want to actually do a life cycle analysis and declare your products according to the life cycle performance up to the end of life. So if you see here on the left, you have the different standards to be followed. That is 21, 24 and 25. And at the end it is 44. Just to run through, it is covering 50% of the validated claims, you get a silver point. 75% it is gold, 100% it is platinum. And then you have platinum plus, that is EPD declaration. That is EPD India, we've already got accredited. And the second level, if you see gold plus. Now carbon footprint is a very buzzword right now, that's saying carbon footprint of the product, as Sir was mentioning. But it's not, I would say practically it's a little difficult thing to do for a product, because whenever you talk about scope 3 emissions, which is very difficult to declare and document. This is the kind of certificate which you get at the end of the certification scheme, mentioning the company name, your product plant name, the product and what environmental claim you have been declaring. So this logo can be used on your product, on your packaging, for your promotion, on your letterheads, at our events, wherever there's a digital promotion done for the companies who certify this, get this certification done. And lastly, it can be enlisted for Griha, IGBC. You could use this as a declared product. So talking about the AEP case which we recently certified. So AEP is in Gujarat, that's Ahmedabad Environmental Projects Limited. They basically work with construction and demolition waste. It's a recycling company which has come up with these products where they have a public-private partnership with the government, where the government takes back almost 40% of their products. And the water used is also completely recycled. So there is an STP plant which is right next to it, and all the water which is used for the production of this paver blocks is recycled water. Now coming to the point of them declaring 100% and we certifying them for only 72%. It is because the way it is calculated and there are additives to it. There is a method of calculation which is according to 1421 which has to be followed. That is the reason the certification was given at the bronze level, and they wanted to declare only the recycled content because their priority was to get enlisted with the Griha certification scheme, because there is a point of there is a threshold of 75% and up where you get certain credits for the system. This took us around a couple of months time to audit. So that is the timeline which you follow for the documentation and the audit. The pricing structure is basically you talk about the application certification fee, registration, and there is a surveillance fee to the certification. If you still have questions, we'll be available. Yeah. Thank you so much.
Hello. Thank you, Nidhi. Now I request Mr. Amol Desai, General Manager, to present his case. Mr. Amol Desai.
Respected dignitaries on the dais and my friends in the audience. I'll be talking about the polystyrene material as a building material for the construction, basically EPS and XPS. See, the perception of EPS, in India we refer this material as thermocol, a very lightweight, fragile, commodity type, used only for decoration. We feel it is not biodegradable, not recyclable. It has no scrap value or the resale value. But we see that the general applications of EPS in decoration in most of the places and in packaging. It is actually one of the beautiful material for the packaging industry, especially for the packaging of white goods, for the packaging of the medicine and the vital organs, the food packaging. But apart from this, the beautiful applications of EPS as a material of construction in various construction technologies. I'll just touch upon all this. We are running short of time, and I will take you through some of the pictures, so which will give you the better insight in what are the products which can be made from EPS. And then we come upon to the sustainability aspect of this material. If you take the two segments, it can be used for the building construction as well as for infrastructure. It can be for the foundation of the buildings. EPS, you can see that it is sandwiched between the two elements, either it is galvanized steel or aluminum or PVC or cement fiber board, used as sandwich panels. They are also used as structural panels, a single panel, M2 panel, or maybe for the stairs, for the flooring. Here we have another concept called ICF, where the blocks are molded just like Lego toys, and they are used for the construction of the building. You have different floor and roof systems where the blocks or the panels are used for making lightweight and insulation. EPS boards are used as insulation materials for number of years now. They are also used for the decorations. You can make the tiles, the rosettes, the cornices as a replacement for POP. Very lightweight, very easy to handle. We don't see these products quite often in Indian industry. EPS beads, that is thermocol beads, are mixed with cement to make it very lightweight concrete. And this is also a very established technology for 25 years abroad, which we are trying to bring in here. EPS blocks are used in infrastructure industry for last more than 40, 45 years. They can be used for bridge underfill applications, as shown in the picture. They can be used as culverts for the road construction, for the railway embankments. And now I will be talking about a little bit on the technology as EPS core panel system. I think my colleague Rajiv will touch upon this system in more detail. Now here we use EPS sheet, which is weaved with wires from both the sides and cross-weaved with galvanized steel. And these sheets are directly used for construction of buildings. You can go from ground to three without use of any beams, columns, or bricks. These are the different steps involved into this. The panels are assembled, and then the adjacent panels are crimped with wires. You can make the channels using hot air gun to make the channels for ducting or for electrical and for plumbing. And when the entire assembly is done, you shotcrete in one go, so you get a monolithic construction, constructed building, structure. And the beauty of this is that EPS is in the center, so it gives the insulation by virtue of its characteristic. You can build better buildings, they give you better construction, the performance is better, and more than that, you get feel more comfort. We have seen that it gives a drop of 6 to 8 degrees in many cities. And this particular system can be used as a solution for every application, from residential, multi-storied, commercial, social, housing for all. Here, there was an approval from BMTPC last year for this system. And then in one of the exhibitions last week, we exhibited this complete house made from this system. There's another material called XPS, which we make from polystyrene. Now, these are insulation boards. We market them as in the name of InsuBoard. SPL is forward integrated into manufacturing of these boards, and they are known for low thermal conductivity, excellent compressive strength, and resistance to moisture. They can be used for overdeck insulation over the terrace after the waterproofing is done. They can also be used for as an underdeck insulation, and they can also be used for wall insulation. XPS is a sustainable building material, very lightweight and inert, very safe to handle. It gives good insulation, so saves energy. There's no aging effect, so the performance is constant for years. It can be reused, there's no degradation. It can be recycled, either in the same form or it can be converted to polystyrene and used. There's a recent development that we used to use pentane gas for manufacturing these boards. Now we can use CO2 gas as a blowing agent, which is in accordance to international requirements. EPS is also an ideal choice as a sustainable building material, known for its energy efficiency, indoor environmental quality, localized manufacturing. There are hundreds of units. You can get the product from any nearby localized manufacturer. Superior insulating properties and improved overall performance of the building envelope. We are committed to sustainability. EPS industry is further committed to sustainability through innovation, either through lean manufacturing process, reduced waste, and comprehensive recycling system. There are a lot of research data from various laboratories worldwide, from Oak Ridge National Laboratories, NRC Canada, and National Association of Home Builders Research Center. EPS LCA reports normally take into consideration of the resource source, the benefits, the energy cost, the emissions to air, water, and soil, either from EPS, from cradle to cradle or cradle to grave applications. It gives returns more than 200 times. There's a reduction in emission of more than 100 times. Energy payback is very fast. And the recapture of greenhouse gas emissions is reported to be less than 10 months. There's one more application which I said in infrastructure. It is called geofoam, where EPS blocks are used. They are very lightweight. The weight is only 100 times that of soil. And it can be made suitable to the applications, and then you can modify the density. The basic applications of geofoam has been known for the lateral load reduction, the roads made on soft soil, for slope stabilization, for dead load reduction on and lightweight structural void filling. These are some of the pictures of the projects which have been executed worldwide. And again, being lightweight material, there is very less pollution from fuel emissions during the transportation. There is no compaction required. Very light machinery is required. It can be reground, recycled, reused, and is not affected by the normal climatic conditions. This particular technology has also been recognized or acknowledged by the ministry recently. About a company, we are basically the manufacturer of polystyrene. We make EPS, we make XPS. And why this certification was required? Because there are many materials and many products claim to be environmental friendly, green or sustainable. So we decided to go with ICMQ, and basically for two of our products, XPS insulation boards and EPS beads in building material products. It will give us some recognition in international markets with eco-labeling, and our aim is to achieve platinum level with EPD. I think Nidhi has already spoken more about the certification, and now I leave it to Mr. Rajiv to talk about the EPS construction system. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Mr. Desai. Now I invite Mr. Rajiv Singhal, Product Manager, Snail India Private Limited, to present his case.
Good morning, everybody, and thank you so much, IICCI, for organizing this seminar on sustainability in building materials. Thank you, everybody on the dais, and thank you so much, ladies and gentlemen. I'll touch upon the system which we call as concrete wall panel system, or EPS core panel system, or there can be many different names to it. Already Mr. Desai has touched a little bit upon the system, and I'll try to make a justification given the time available for us is only 10 minutes, and you cannot discuss much about a construction system in 10 minutes, but I'll try to do as much justification as possible with this. All right, so what we have here is, as Mr. Kumar or Dr. Kumar of CBR has also already mentioned, we need over 1 billion square meters of public buildings in India in the next 5 to 7 years. And if you think about doing it with your regular construction systems or regular techniques, I think we do not have the requisite labor force. We do not have the requisite area required to accommodate this labor force in temporary housing. So we need a solution which is mechanized. We need a solution which is affordable in terms of sustainability in environmental conditions, as well as in terms of affordability or the comfort level for living, as already discussed upon by Mr. Seth of Terry. In India, we are having a lot of earthquake active regions. Please remember, there are most of the places in India are falling under earthquake zone 3, 4, or 5. And we have high energy requirements because most of the construction that is happening across India is based on RCC, which is reinforced concrete, cementitious concrete, and brick structures. Somebody said, Dr. Kumar said, there are 100,000 brick kilns in India, which are producing 250 billion of bricks, and you need 1,000 degrees Celsius temperature for 5 hours to produce a brick. So remember, we are using a lot of embodied energy. We are also depleting the topsoil when we are using these brick kilns, which are running illegally in case. Earthquake resistance, the fire resistance. It provides a certified quality of building by a third party. So we are talking about third party verification here. We're talking about reduction in operational cost of the building, which is because of the energy efficiency of the building. And we provide, this helps also in reduction of litigation with customers because you have a system which is recognized, accepted, approved by the statutory bodies. The panels as such, what we call as panels, is a system comprising of undulated form of EPS sheets, EPS which is already discussed upon by Mr. Desai. And it is on both the sides. This EPS sheet is enclosed in two layers of GI meshes, galvanized steel. Again, the steel is galvanized for anti-rusting properties, so you increase the durability or the life cycle of the steel. Then you, on this factory-made component, so this is factory-made component, you reduce the amount of energy required to build it on site and the manpower required to build it on site. It is sprayed with structural mortar on site or done a precast. This is fast assembly in situ, increased speed of in the finishing works. You reduce the time required for electrical and the plumbing for it. You can reduce the manpower by 60% required for making a conventional building with a similar approach. We reduce 30-40% in construction time vis-a-vis the conventional methods. Quality, as I again repeat, these are pre-qualified materials which are third-party verified with factory production control. There are high quality during the completion stages because these are again monitored by a third party for the quality control. Then, as I repeat again, it has high quality of finishing. We reduce the requirement for waterproofing. The waterproofing is very excellent with this system. Again, their eco certification is certified by a third party. We already, in fact, one of the materials which is being provided, which is the raw material, is EPS, is again undergoing the Get It Green certification. Same is the case with the steel that is being used here. We reduce the embodied energy because we are able to reduce the quantity of steel and cement required to build this. As compared to a conventional building where I am using 3.5 kgs or 4 kgs of steel per square feet of built-up area, here we are reducing only 2 to 2.5 kg of steel per square feet of built-up area. Remember, this is a completely RCM or reinforced cementitious mortar building. There are no bricks, there are no blocks. Yet, we are able to reduce the quantity of steel and cement going in the building. And it is safe, not only during construction, this is safe not only during the life cycle of the building. So you have high earthquake resistance because these are monolithic structures. If I have to compare with a day-to-day commodity or with day-to-day usage, the cars that we use today are much lighter as compared to the cars that were used 30 years ago. Yet these cars are safer as compared to the cars which were used 30 years ago, entirely because of their monolithic approach in construction. The same is applied in this case. We have a monolithic building. When you shake this building, when you shake the building on one side, all the other four sides of the building respond equally to it. So, you know, it is like going back on the, I'll touch upon it later in the next slide. The thermal insulation, as I repeat, is a differentiating factor for both affordable housing, which is social housing, as well as for luxury housing. Because these buildings can be upmarket as well. We have seen people selling it as upmarket in India, the developers. Also, for the social housing, because you practically eliminate the need for an air conditioner. We have an example in Angul, in Odisha, where the temperatures at this point of time, during these days in April and early May, go up to 47 and 48 degrees Celsius, one of the highest, because all of this area is surrounded by a lot of thermal power plants and industries like steel plants and aluminium plants. Here people have, the people living in these buildings, even in the top floors, they're not using air conditioners. So we can eliminate the usage of air conditioners if we have proper thermal insulation in the buildings, and that really makes a game changer for affordable housing. You don't want them to be living in an oven, as Dr. Kumar mentioned. In fact, when we studied, we remember the glass buildings as greenhouse buildings, which are normally used in cold climates where you want to make a nursery, or you know, you grow some vegetables. Otherwise, which is not possible. Light yet strong, as I said, monolithic. I reduce the quantity of steel and cement going inside, yet the building is stronger. Remember, if I have to break one finger, it is much easier than to break all five together. It's the same principle. If I have to break one wall, if I have to fell down one wall, it is much easier as to bring down the complete house in one go. Is that not possible? And then our association with the ICMQ and the chambers has been that we have seen this third-party verified green parameters are easily recognized and accepted by the various agencies as well as the developers. Then for the contractors, for the people who are building with these systems, it provides a sound business proposition for them, because they find something which is easier to recognize, easier to quantify, as well as reduced litigation from the the customer side. And the other factor which has been good for us is that the complete chain, we are now in the process of bringing a complete chain under Gated Green certification scheme. So from the raw materials, the EPS, the polystyrene, to the cement, to the steel, to the end application of the building. So every part of the construction will be, you know, Gated Green certified. So when you say, I want this building, I want a green rated, platinum green rated building, we have the solution right away for you, and you can just use those techniques to get it done. No need to individually verify different elements going inside the building. With that, I'd like to thank you. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Mr. Singhal. Now I would request Mr. Ajay Singh to present his case. Mr. Ajay Singh.
Good morning to all. I would like to first of all thank IISCCI for giving us this opportunity to just share with you our experience. Apart from that, already Alok has advised me that the time is short, so you be very fast. I'll try to be as fast as possible. Just to give you a little background on our company, we are the oldest company as far as insulation goes. We are 58 years old company. One of the largest manufacturers of thermal insulation products. And we have been associated with almost all projects in the country in one way or the other, either as a manufacturer, that is material supplier, or otherwise as turnkey contractor. So we have been, since inception, we have been, always our endeavor has been to give products which are energy efficient, and that has been our core area. Just to give you a little more idea about how committed we are, we have been part of the technical committee in BIS for thermal insulations, and apart from thermal insulations, other committees also we have been a part of it. We have been also the member of the core committee of experts for drafting of ECBC 2007. Then apart from that, we are also the core members of the latest association that we have formed for IIF, which is Indian Insulation Forum, where we invite all the insulation people, all manufacturers, all stakeholders to come in and share their ideas as well as their experiences, so that we can promote this insulation in a wide way across the country, which is the need of the hour today. Then we are also active members of ISHRAE and ASHRAE. And then we have been promoting this insulation, building insulation, right from Now, even before this green movement started, of green building, the wave started. Before that, we have been doing this. And in the 90s, in fact, we did the first insulation building insulation in the country in a mall in Delhi. Of late, we have been also associated with the NBC to have who have covered special chapter on, they have brought in a special chapter on sustainability construction, and insulation has got a part in it to play. we all know we are a tropical country, so thermal insulation, over here most of the time the ambience are very high. All the year round you will find that almost 7 to 8 months we have hot period. So here insulation becomes even more important, because how insulation helps, just I'll give you. So we do roof and wall insulation for that. This is what I wanted to just show you, that a building which is not insulated and the building which is insulated as per ECBC, this is the kind of temperature ingress that you are able to stop, which is almost up to the level of 75%. So what does the thermal insulation do is actually it gives you a relief of almost 7 to 8 degree from the ambience inside the building. So it adds to your, of course, it gives you the advantage of energy conservation, that is less energy being used for air conditioning. Second thing is important is human comfort. It also adds to the human comfort. This is a typical example which is showing that with 50 mm thick insulation envelope, you are having almost, the temperature difference is almost from the ambient is around 13.9 degree inside. The benefits of insulation is, yes, environmental issues are, of course, energy, even a single unit saved is equivalent, you are, that is an extra unit being manufactured. So you are saving on the fossil fuels and even GHS. Then economical advantage, obviously, that your air conditioning loads would reduce. And the third thing is social, that is, as I said, human comfort. We are manufacturers of rock wool, which is made from rocks. It has the biggest advantage that it is a non-combustible product, and apart from having good insulation properties, it gives you even acoustic properties. Then we are manufacturers of polyurethane and polyisocyanurates. I will not get into the details of the product chemistry or how it is done, just a little bit on what. Then apart from that, we are also manufacturers of prefabricated insulated panels of both rock wool, PIR, as well as polyurethanes. And with this, you can have buildings made with just panels which are energy efficient. These are the few applications that we'd like to show. For these insulations can be used in buildings which are existing or otherwise new construction, for walls, and this is for roofs. Buildings which are already there, and then you would think of retrofitting them, then underdeck insulations can be done with both fibrous as well as rigid insulation. Overdeck insulation with polyurethanes. We have spray applications which are very fast and highly efficient. Sandwich applications as well as cavity fills. Internal partitions which can act apart from, of course, compartmentizing the building. You can also have acoustics with these. Wall insulation with sprays, which make them a composite construction, And this, apart from, of course, it adds to the strength of the building and doesn't allow the moisture to pass through. This is how, as per the ACBC, for 24 hours, the various thicknesses that you require, we do the designing, we do manufacturing, and do the complete erection of these insulation materials, taking a single point responsibility. This is for daytime. Here I would just like to add that yes, best of insulation, any material, best of materials can fail if not properly applied. So, and one thing, of course, we would like to highlight that yes, insulation should be taken seriously considered as a component, and it has to be, you know, integrated with the design in the initial stage itself. Otherwise, an afterthought always turns out to be a little expensive. Thank you. I hope I have been right in time.
Thank you very much for all the distinguished panelists and all the audience for taking time to be here today. I'd just like all the panelists to please stand up for a group photograph, and then we can close the session. Thank you.